My name is Ajay Kelkar, and I know that all of you are technical folks, and I know that these could be spent learning techniques and careers. So I'm a little bit of an outlier in this group. I'm not a technology guy, but I worked in technology for a long time. And a quick introduction, I started my career in public government 3 years ago, and then spent about 9 years in consumer goods, then spent 5 years in retailing at the same shop stop. I spent a little over 5 years in agency, like the same place. And then over the last 10 years, am I working in doctors in a small group? Is this where? So then post that, for the last 10 years, I've been, I started a company called Hansa Cequity with my partner called Hansa. And we work with companies who have data and leverage that data for marketing. That's really a quick background of what I need. What I'm going to cover today is about, I think I've got about 30 minutes, right? So I'm going to go very fast. I actually enjoy going very fast, so you know, don't stop me if I'm going too fast. But so what I'm going to cover is I'm going to spend about 5 minutes just giving a context to the perspective in which I have seen data, which is really marketing and business. And after that, I will tell you a few stories about data, right? That's the idea, that's what I'm going to do. I also don't want this to be a one-way street, so I'm very happy stopping in between, you know, taking questions or interacting. So it's not a one-way street, I think, when it's really all time. So quickly, the title, the reason I added this was, all of you would have heard of analysis leads to paralysis, right? It's an old saying, and often, and a decade ago when I started this company, even the word analytics was not so common. I think today probably quick data, data science, analytics, even a chadawala might know these words, but that time they were really uncommon. And the common sentiment used to be that instinct drives, and instinct is what we drive business on. Data was not necessarily so well recognized. I think things have changed, and to that extent, there's much more recognition that can have really huge value. And the new age companies, which is the Googles, Apples, Amazons, all of them, have made that the core of the business. And because of which, I think other legacy companies are following. But I think even then, most companies find it difficult to absorb, adopt, and leverage analytics. I've been there within companies, and I've seen outside companies trying to help them do that. So I know that that's the problem. And either a data science team becomes a central unit which does good work but may not get as accepted all over, or business people feel that they know exactly what they know and they are not doing wrong. Either way, it's not easy for people to navigate and to build the data oriented philosophy. So that's really So starting with this, just the perspective that I want to build is that most companies, you know, if you look at a balance sheet of a company, even the furniture would be fixed assets, but customer data is not there. Okay, so companies don't really value their data as an asset, and I think there's a need even from an accounting standards point of view to start to change that. But interestingly, one of the best ways to make that change is that companies like Amazon and others have proven that if you create a moat, which is a barrier for consumers, for competitors, by creating a data-led strategy, it can be very powerful. So I think that's the core, that how to start valuing data. And I think for all of you and for what I've done in the past or I do currently, I think the importance is to keep understanding how can you bring that value of data in everyday decisions. Because it's not that you value data as a philosophy, but if I'm in a bank and I give a loan, am I valuing the data and using that data to give a loan? If I'm a DTH company, we work with a DTH company, Tata Sky. When I sell on the phone, when you have a call in, do I value the data? If I'm a retailer, you know, working to a source, do I value the data? So I think the data value needs to transfer from that perspective. And I think the point I'm making is that whether you're a data analyst or a data scientist or a senior person in a company, I think there's a large need for socializing. The challenge in adopting analytics is not a technical problem. It's not like earlier people built linguistic regression, and now they're doing machine learning, and so they're going to be adopted better. It is really a social problem of being able to explain immediately and actually talk about issues which are linked to data. And that's where the gap takes tends to be, right? Because, and I will touch upon this later, what tends to happen is that the guys and the ladies who are done good with data, who are great algo geeks, some of them may have great personalities too, but to bring that together, they will be taught that it's important to have a great personality to complete. Because very often people start to believe that, look, I'm a great geek, I love my algorithms, that's good enough. And just not. If you want people to love, you've got to be able to communicate. So that is an important message over here. And it's also a huge cultural shift at a personal level for most people who are technical, and also at a company level to accept when someone like you might articulate that don't take a decision like this, but take it to the data. To accept that as a culture. So this is a challenge for companies. Quickly, I want to introduce a topic around the word called data wars. How many of you have heard of the word called data wars? You heard of value wars, you heard of early wars, right? Now, this is word called data wars. This is really about these companies, all of them who are really data wars. They are hungry for data, they absorb data, they live on data, they breathe on data, and they build algorithms on the data. We as consumers look very effective. Reach new issues around data privacy, around other things, but these companies are changing the nature of companies. So when I am the banker, when I am an agency, I would see many ICICI or Citibank in my competition, right? But today I can't afford to do that. Because today for me, competition could come from Google, or tomorrow Amazon was to launch a bank, it could be Amazon. You can see in the retail world, again in my days in retailing and even today my current clients who are retailers, they no longer see only a physical retailer's competition. Right, because online business is coming in, and all of us as consumers, we do 80% of our research definitely online, and maybe we might buy a combination online and off. Right? So the traditional boundary lines of who's my competitor has changed completely. Right? And it has changed with the new players who are coming in for data rich. And therefore, what do companies who are old age companies, not new age companies, who are not data rich, do to try and enable themselves in this new data war age? I think that's the concept that I'm talking about. I'm quickly touching upon this. In earlier days, in the 70s, brands were important. How important a brand? You need to go build a brand, right? Post that, in the decade, maybe post 80s, retailers became important. So retailers had cloud, Google has formed, retailers could bargain with the manufacturer and so on. I think now, it has moved from the age of brands to the age of retailers to the age of the customer. And so therefore, we as customers, have far more cloud than we ever imagined. Unfortunately, this cloud is decentralized. It's not aggregated, but it is cloud, and therefore it's become the age of the customer from the perspective of this whole industry. And the only point I want to leave on this slide for you is that what I mentioned earlier, that companies therefore want to adopt that. They want to use your algorithms, they want to build new machine learning technologies to be able to leverage the data they have. But for them to bring it into their business operations is not easy, not trivial, and the struggle to do that. All of you who are participating in the industry in some way need to know that and play a role in that. So sometimes, in my agency, in my days, for example, one of the things that I would do is to take, like those years, early 2000, the word data scientists were not just about around there, right? It's become very popular now. But I used to ensure that the junior most person in the team would present, for example, to Aditya Puri in a meeting. So that he or she gets a flavor for what will this very senior person have to put in the end of this time. How would he absorb data, right? And I think that becomes important for those who work with data, seek out some opportunities, because finally, if companies don't change their mind, don't change their culture, they won't adopt as much of something as they require. And that's important for us, right? And then those who do it well, the other piece we have to talk about is that it's not only data, but it's about your company's vision, it's about how you want users to leverage their data, customer experience. Finally, it must make a difference with the point of consumption. That's it. So how many of you think that analysts should be storytellers? Why do you feel analysts should be
storytellers? We want to tell, express data, or express what problem you are trying to solve. Tell it in a story form, it is more understandable to the people you are trying to explain, and it gives a more clear and in-depth understanding of what you are trying to
do. It's easier to understand.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Story, many examples people have done, I'm sure some of you have experience telling stories.
Or rain
And I'll give you a small anecdote, right? So, a few years back, we were working for this DTH company, and we were analyzing inbound call center records, right? Because the company had said that even in India, the subscriber base ramps up very rapidly, the number of people calling our call center has gone up greatly. And then therefore, look at that data and do the analytics for us to tell us who's calling us, right? So, how many of you know of a technique like CHAID? C-H-A-I-D, CHAID, POCAR. Okay, there are these techniques which are classification techniques which allow you to segment a bunch of customers or any other data points into distinctly different clusters. And it's in a tree form. So the start with a parent child relationship throughout the structure, right? And so you could start by saying that 100% of the people call from there, maybe one tree branch to talk about people who are new subscribers. The other three branches say people who are old subscribers. Then they would say, you know, old subscribers, the other three below that might say people who are, you know, older or vintage or more than 6 years, and so on. Are you guys getting the picture? What is the right? Now if you imagine, all of your technique is clear in this room. Am I right? All of your technique, right? So despite that, CHAID may not be a familiar technique. Now in this particular case, my team of data scientists did this work, analyzed the call center records, they had some lovely findings, and they had charts from that CHAID algorithm. And they put it into a presentation, right? The next task was to meet the managing director and present it. Now, tell me, how many of you think this would be a complex idea for you to absorb, especially this together with these colleagues? How many of you feel so? Yeah? It would be complex. A lot of data has been done. It is a little complex, right? So one of my analysts had a wonderful idea, and he told a story in a phenomenal way, and I'll just tell you what the story was. He started, he bounced it off of me first, and I said, wow, this is fantastic, cool. And he was very, very concerned with the important meeting that he was there. So the meeting started, and I handed over to the analyst. The analyst said that, sir, I'm going to explain to you a technique we use as data scientists in a very different way first. So will you give me 5 minutes without thinking about your business? First, immediate guts to them, right? Because you're not even a senior guy, every minute is valuable. You're a little puzzled, he said, no, can you do 5 minutes? So he said, sir, have you heard of Titanic? Yeah. So he put up a graphic and said that I analyzed the people who died in the Titanic. How do you know about the Titanic, right? So I analyzed the data set, people who died in the Titanic disaster, right? And I developed the following part of it. So he said, what do you do? So I said, we analyzed it, and he said that I found some simple rules that if you are a man, the chances of your dying in the Titanic were higher than if you were a woman. If you were a man and you were married, the chances were a little lower than if you were a man who was single. If you were a man who was married with children, the chances were even lower. If you were a woman and single, the chances were a little higher but lower than the man. If you were a woman married with children, the chances were lower, and so on. And you put that whole tree up. Is this logical? That when the boat was sinking, people, obviously the first thing people said that women and children were the first to have lifeboats. Then obviously the probability to go back and analyze it was shaping up like, is this common sense? It's understandable. Punch did me explain this, right? And once the MBI spirit, which was a 5 minute job, he said, now how does it relate to my business? So the next chart was 100 people called your call center, and this is how they split up. Right? What do you guys think? Is there a nice way of presenting in that here? Very different way, right? Now, what are they trying to do? When you do something like this, you should have been small. But the point I'm going to make here is that what you constantly need to do is to look at the data and explain it using a narrative. Often we don't powerfully think through a narrative when we look at our data. And after we analyze the data, the narrative has come out. But we don't spend too much time talking about the data. So once you do that, the explanation is far easier. And then you link it to images or visuals. Right, like the Titanic sinking and all of that, and the combination is insight. So when you link all of these three things together, the combination is insight, and the moment there is insight about data, there is a readiness to take a decision. And that's when people start to say, okay, I'm going to take a decision. And then, is this concept clear? Is there any questions around that? I'm not going to ask in they feel you guys want to discuss something, happy to do that. Is this concept clear so far? The idea? Sure. The point is that you have data, right? And if you use the narrative of the data, people who have seen the data, because there is an overriding narrative, then you will bring an understanding far better, right? And then you use visuals around the data. What happens is that if you start to use visuals, the narrative of the data, the visualization helps you really understand that better. And then finally, you can use the narrative, the data, and the visuals together, and therefore you are able to cover all of it, the engaging stuff. And then you start to engage, you start to say, okay, and you will see this data. Right? And this journey is not, the skills are not that of only within the world. They are really largely social skills produced by storytelling. And that's why the topic of the radio. And I want to move a little bit and say that compare this to the world's jungle. It's amazing that today all of us consumers are absorbing far more data in our newspapers and media than we ever did before. Is that right?
Yeah.
And why is that? Same way your chart, journalists realize they stitch a narrative and they tell you, you start picking it up. But let me give you an example of, some of you may have seen it, I don't know, how many of you have seen this in New York Times, Ajay simulators?
Yeah,
some of you have seen it. Interesting thing is that, this was a simulator which asked people before budgeting time in the US to go to this app. Use the data, economic data that was available to the president of the USA, right, and his finance team, and help in making the budget the way they believe the budget should be made. Right? And it was very simple, very intuitive. All the underlying data was there, but look at the way it was assembled. And you could start with things like saying, okay, I want to cut foreign aid in half, right? That's my overriding narrative. Now go and tell the people of the United States that I want to cut foreign aid by half. Right? And you could play with that and come up with something. Now, tell me how many companies, every company has an annual operating plan, a budget. How many companies build an app like this to do their annual operating plan or budget? How many of you have seen that? Right? It's a simple technique used by journalists, can be ported, transported to the industrial world, can be done well by technical people who are good at this. The moment the intersection of telling a story and why that story is to be told, right? So, this is an example of it which I thought would resonate. The other point to make is that very often when we do a lot of data science work, the belief is that the effort we have taken to do this work should be justification for people to take the decision, right? Which is, oh, I've done very hard work, now it's your job to buy an analysis. Versus saying, no, it's my job to sell this, right? And which is when the story technique starts becoming much, much more powerful. You see, I will sell this data inside to get you to take this. And also, what's happening more and more is that for a lot of people who are younger, data is becoming very obvious, right? Today, if I put it in narrow road, but a couple of years back, my daughter is 21, she's 16, 17, some years back. And if you're going somewhere, if I ask for directions, you get very angry to Google Maps there, right? Today, a few days back, I was reading Google Maps now gives you, when you look for a restaurant, I'm not writing this up, I read about it. If you look for a restaurant, it can give you an average wait time. So it means if I'm looking to walk my Chinese food in Bane Road, and I can, if there are six Chinese restaurants, I can quickly assemble wait time amongst a group and say, boss, let's go to this place. Right? So the younger crowd, all of you and many others, are becoming data savvy by behavior in their day-to-day life. So when you do this, you come to your work, you will say that, why is my annual budget at the first thing he says? Why can't I have an app? Right? And so that's moving, that's changing, that's up changing that. Okay. I just want to pause for a minute. How are we on time?
We have got another 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
Yeah.
So then I think I will move a little fast. Any questions so far? Yeah.
So you gave the example of New York Times showing the data with you. Now this problem in trying to sell this kind of visualization or an app is something important. Most of them don't want to ask this. They don't want people to know. That is why they put the data in a format in which it is not easy to consume. That is precise reason why they don't.
Right.
So how do you sell it to these kind of people? Or how should we simply think upon that? Or is there some way in which you can have find such kind of
problem? Simply, most times people are not so worried about doing data as they are about taking the decision that they want to take. And they are worried that the data will actually assemble a logic which is against their decision. Therefore, the point is that I'm not saying that you have that point of view. Now, the question is that if you are able to show that an app like this can assemble the argument much better for their own decision, then you are changing the nature of the argument completely. Right? And that's the difference. You said the first one point you to say that cost reduction next year is the main theme for this company. Here's the way to do it. So the narrative that you must sell it to that MD or the CMI has to be about this decision. And that's the change that you should. So I'll just quickly move, if you want to take one example that I'll raise to this, but let's take retail as an example. And let's say you're a retail manager and you want to take some decisions around sales and you're in a retail weekly meeting near sales. So what tends to happen is that retail is a very catchment that business. So people look at that catchment and say, how is within 5 kilometers what's going on? So you need to understand that catchment behavior, what's going on in that catchment, and then identify options for growth and how to continue. That's the task. Right? So let's say you take this example and look at the basic data for this group of people, for this bunch of stores, and you saw it for a long period of time and there were some spikes over here. So more and more clear narrative was really coming out when people the planning meeting, people said, okay, how do I look at what should I have I what's the viewing? And then we said, okay, let's look at this a little differently. Let's look at analyzing this only at a pin code. So you've got, let's say, 15 stores in one city in Mumbai. Let's look at analyzing this full data on the basis of pin code information. And then see if some trends or some narrative on top of that. And then recommend what to do. Right? So, when you start changing the thinking that way, then even if in one pin code there are 3 stores or 2 stores, put them together. And you assemble the database as pin codes. Right? So then you look at it and you say, okay, there is how the data is looking, but when you do this, you the dynamic chart, but my keyboard is going to be there today, so I will be able to do it. But the idea was to take the dynamic chart, it shows a cohort of inputs and how they are actually moving. Right? And identify a particular pin code is moving really better than others, where there seems to be, for some reason, a better sales traction. And look at that data and try to say, okay, so what's going on in that pin code? What's the story there? And then look at whether what's happening to the customer shopping. Right? So, and then you find the particular pin code where you have the stagnancy, because in this particular pin code, there aren't any customers coming in regularly. So repeat shoppers coming down. And so therefore you should actually recognize the problem, which is my pin code may define these problems differently, and this particular pin code is an issue of number of customers. So then you say look at the previous and segment of the pin codes. And look at understanding these different segments. These segments again you use a technique like chair or other segmentation techniques to cluster these pin codes. So remember right from the start I'm changing the whole narrative from staying for the full 15 stores in that city to per pin code going up. And when I'm doing that, why I'm doing that is that I want this to move to a determinant itself. To say, each store, who's a computer near that store, what's happening within a system, within kilometers, and therefore how will customer behavior change as the landscape changes. Right? And so therefore, all of this allows you to start changing the data completely from looking at purely sales to a question first of what's happening in the pin code, and the next question of saying what's happening in the pin code, and therefore, going on from here, we go in and say, okay, some pin codes have much more competition, with much more intensity, and therefore our communication effort should be different, and I should do things very different. Right? So that's something clear. Now, if you see the example again was the narrative was created and visuals were created, and you brought these two together with the engagement. And the output you wanted from that was to say that there are 3 pin codes you want to take specific action on, and you want them to sketch the art. Right? Is that clear? And that's how the goal. Now another example would be that if you take you have a retail store, they want to understand their brands much better. It's a parallel store selling multiple brands. And their buyers, for the people who analyze who you sell to, understanding of segmentation of their brand. So it means that by type of product as a value, the y-axis, and the type of brand, you have to segment with the more fashionable, less fashionable, with the x-axis. And they have slotted into the y-axis. But then, when you said, you know, what the, how you slotted your brands, but what if you change the narrative to say that I think your brands should be positioned differently, right? Maybe they are positioned correctly. So you have a brand which you are calling high fashion, but maybe being sold differently. So now, when I can look at the data completely differently, keeping this narrative in mind, or drawing the narrative out of the data, when we did that, what we found was actually many brands move. Because you saw that the one brand, for example, had a high price tag, medium price tag, and low price tag. Because earlier we find a medium brand, but only low price tag was really working with. So when you separate data, you could find that several 16 brands were actually in a different grid, right? So to finish this 2-hour meeting with this narrative that there are some specific brands whose positioning needs to match the offer on the ground, right? Again, clear narrative, clear visualization allowing you to change the focus of how data can be used. So similarly, I just quickly this one. Again, a bunch of stores in Bangalore are not doing well, and then you compare them to the rest of the country, there's a gap. So look at this and say, okay, why are the old stores in one market not performing as much as other stores? And you try to understand that. And then you get back, you said, okay, there are some gaps in this data. And then you analyze that, the idea was that then you get to a point where you have a narrative about how the Bangalore stores are not doing well due to a bunch of specific reasons. So we looked at that, we found that actually, and this is two details we will not proceed here, but actually the way urban development is, we actually map Google Map data with location start points and store locations. So and the distance and Google Map time data. And we said, you know what, some stores are not doing well, and that this construction is leading to a longer lead time for their richest catchment, their most significant catchment, right? And so therefore, then budgets got replaced and we try to do this very quickly. Now, the final problem, for example, very often what happens in data analysis, you run a large data set of data. So in this case, in this analysis, you're looking at estimating viable products together. So, four purchases. So you look at, what is the FND score, the product 1 and product 2, you buy this together. Now, this is fine because there are only 5, 6 rows or 7 rows over here. But imagine if there are 1,000 rows, how do you bring this up? And so therefore, what problem in university was if you put this into our product 4 occurrence chart, the bubble size indicating very specifically what the intensity was, and the color indicating to how it should be different product. And suddenly, with that app, whatever app, you are able to provide to the user very easy for people to understand and take action on it. So, the key again is how you go about this. Right? So, I want to switch to what you keep saying. Today, also, what's happening is there's a lot of external data available. I want to give you an example. Let's take an example of there is noise data available in some cities. So, in New York City, for example, you have decibel noise and complaints per report or another. Now, if you take an India example, you find many other such external data sets which are possible, and you can add value within the data for the kind of business you're in, depending on what business you're in. But here, I've taken an example of saying, if noise data is available, how can air be able to do something very different? So if you look at this, what you can do is that if air being, or how many of you use air being? Quite a few people, right? So when you're trying to rent a property, you're going to get, say, Singapore for a holiday. And I'm trying to rent a place, and this actually happened. I took Airbnb, I took a lovely place apartment in Singapore for 5 days. Everything was perfect. It's just that what didn't show up on Airbnb was the building and the construction resource. And so it had a lot of noise. Now, if Airbnb can use this earlier data, which is external noise data, and when I look at the properties that are looking at it, if they could match that data up and give me an index of this zip code being this noisy. Right? Suddenly it changes my narrative about how I will buy. As a customer, how will I buy? Right? And so therefore, this is an example of using data to actually completely change the product construct and bring in an element of customer behavior that didn't exist earlier. And there's many such data which are available. Right? So, my last section. How many of you recognize this four times in the many of you might have. Not so many. So, how many of you recognize the name Hans Cequity? How many of you don't recognize this name? Might you have taken videos? So I thought that the best way to talk about how to tell a story between data is to show a master, because that's the
visualization is right at the heart of my own work too. I teach global health. And I know having the data is not enough. I have to show it in ways people both enjoy and understand. Now, I'm going to try something I've never done before. Animating the data in real space with a bit of technical assistance from the crew. So, here we go. First, the next is for health. Life expectancy from 25 years to 75 years. And down here, an access to wealth, income per person, $400,000, $4,000, and $40,000. So down here is poor and sick, and up here is rich and healthy. Now, I'm going to show you the world 200 years ago, in 1810. Here come all the countries. Europe, France, Asia, West, Middle East, Green, Africa, South of Sahara, Blue, and the Americas, Yellow. And the size of the country bubble showed the size of the population. And in 1810, it was pretty crowded down there, wasn't it? All countries were sick and poor. Life expectancy were below 40 in all countries. And only the UK and the Netherlands were slightly better off, but not much. And now, I start the world. The Industrial Revolution makes countries in Europe and elsewhere move away from the rest. But the colonized countries in Asia and Africa are stuck down there. And eventually, the Western countries get happier and healthier. And now, we slow down to show the impact of the First World War and the Spanish flu epidemic. What a catastrophe! And now I speed up through the 1920s and the 1930s. And in spite of the Great Depression, Western countries forge on towards greater wealth than ever. Japan and some others tried to follow, but most countries stay down here. Now, after the tragedies of the Second World War, we stop a bit to look at the world in 1948. 1948 was a great year. The war was over, Sweden topped the medal table at the Winter Olympics, and I was born. But the differences between the countries of the world was wider than ever. The United States was in the front, Japan was catching up, Brazil was way behind, Iran was getting a little richer from oil, but still had short lives. And the Asian powers, China, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Indonesia, they were still poor and sick down here. But look what is about to happen. Here we go again. In my lifetime, former colonies gained independence, and then finally they started to get healthier and healthier and healthier. And in the 1970s, then countries in Asia and Latin America started to catch up with the Western countries. They became the emerging economies. Some in Africa follows. Some Africans were stuck in civil war and others hit by HIV. And now we can see the world today in the most up-to-date statistics.
So, interesting, right? When you start telling a story, it takes the data to a very new level, big changes in it. And just to wrap up, two points. So, really, data science, data analytics is not a technical problem as much as it is a social problem. And it is how do you explain and how do you tell stories. That's the key to my students. And so, there was both left and right. It's also not just a theoretical problem, it's something just we linked to the last slide. So, I think the Googles of the world do it so effectively that this is a bit wrong. Other overheads come to talk about it. So, how do you link that data analysis and work into business? That's the key. And I hope all of you will go ahead and do more dynamics without paralysis. That's all I have. Any questions?